Machiavelli, he states that nothing brings a leader more prestige than great enterprises, demonstrating his or her abilities. At the same time, this will occupy any possible room for conspiracy within the organization or territory. Do you think that your personal campaigns, activities against injustice around the world, whether intended or not, have had an impact on your personal success as a leader?
That's a very good question, whether or not my campaigning has had a success of me as a leader. I would think so. I don't think it has brought, on the business level, any extra money into the, you know, the company. It's not, you know, cause-related marketing, because when you fight for human rights or you're challenging Shell or ExxonMobil, it's not going to put, people aren't going in and buying more lipstick. But I think in terms of your, how authentic you are as a leader on these issues, yeah, I think so. I think, you know, when I stand up, when the Dalai Lama, considered the spiritual leader of the world, opened up our campaign in the Jimmy Carter Center in Atlanta, which was Make Your Mark, where we managed to have, in that 6 months, 12 million customers, or not even customers, come into our shops and put their thumbprint to defend human rights defenders. When it ended up in a Quai d'Orsay theater in Paris with thousands and 100,000 people cheering because Bruce Springsteen was there, or Radiohead, or Alanis Morissette, or Peter Gabriel, all giving their time free for human rights defenders. And when the Dalai Lama walked with me on the stage and put his arms out to these thousands and thousands of kids with their mouths open as he walked to the end of the stage saying, look, this is a real you, defend human rights defenders. Yeah, that helps my reputation as a authentic human rights worker, there's no doubt, because it's not just, in terms of the thinking of leadership, it is not the rhetoric. You've got to take the rhetoric and including in that the action of social change, the action of human rights, justice. It's got to be the walking the talk, and leaders should do that, not just stay in the background in their bloody fancy cars and their really high pay packages and just, you know, throw out a couple of words to the masses. And my people I work with always want more from me than I can give. Every one of them, you know, what are you doing about this subject? Why aren't you here doing this? Like, you know, I'm 64, I haven't got much time left. You know, but their expectation of you is much higher, and that's a real burden in many ways. But that's the nature of leadership. And you're only a leader when people think you are as a leader. You're not a leader if they don't think you are. They think you're just so because you're a financial CEO or something else. You know, you're head of marketing, but you're a wanker. You're not really doing much stuff. When they think of you as a leader, then you are a leader. So the work, the campaigning I did, and continue to do, which is my DNA, is my thumbprint, travels with me. When I left the body shop, it traveled with me. There's a really good piece of advice I've got, which worked for me but might not work for them, which is this French expression, laissez-majeste, which means making fun of the leader, taking the majesty and making it less, taking the leader and making it less. And we used to do this in 100 ways. We have to have an annual report and accounts, it's an official document, you know, to the city about how much money we've made. So we'd always have jokes in there, like, you know, there's a photograph of me with all the wrinkles and say, this is me trying to tell a joke in the, you know, this is me arguing with my husband in the boardroom, you know. And any time that I wanted things done or I'd get all my staff to ring up Gordon and, you know, say he's getting boring and do something different. So there was always a way of taking the notion that you should be up there on the pinnacle, but actually your action is down there. So for example, I went out in the morning at 5 o'clock with the guys who distribute all our products in the trucks, just to see what it's like to get into a shop at 7 o'clock in the morning and put the products on the shelves. So every time my advice is, your values change when your actions change, and you've got to change by experiences. You can't say you understand a shop worker who's there for 7 hours or 8 hours a day, and, you know, lives in a little flat, hasn't got the time to iron his shirt. You've got to understand that. So experiences, I think, get more experiences in different parts of your company. And it's lonely. It's lonely. And trying to find fraternities or sororities or people in your same position where you can learn from and where you can, you know, get advice from, I think that's important.